Colorado. I have a question for you regarding Solomon. In the past week, there's been an article in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and I believe it's Business Week, that were rather unflattering as far as what's going on with the management and your selection. There seems to be a somewhat of a cultural clash there. I don't know that to be a fact, but I wondered, number one, how you keep yourself open to bad news before it's news, and what is going on in Solomon there, the compensation plan, et cetera. How do you think that culturally is going to work out?
Charlie and I are always, we are more interested in bad news always than good news. We figure good news takes care of itself. And one, we only give a couple of instructions to people when they go to work for us. And one of them is to think like an owner, and the second one is to just tell us the bad news immediately, because good news takes care of itself. And we can take bad news, but we don't like bad news late. So I would say in connection with Solomon that there is and has been some culture clash, and there probably almost always would be a culture clash in a business where there is that amount of tension, and whether it be the entertainment business or the investment banking business or the sports business. There's going to be a certain amount of tension when between compensation to the people that work there and compensation to the owners. And I think there's been some, that strain has existed at Solomon from the day I was first there and far before that. I mean, that was no surprise. It's understandable. You're seeing a tension actually in the airline business between the people that work there and capital, and it's produced terrible results in the airline business. And the people that work there have been able to and I'm not talking about U.S. Air specifically, although that's a case, but it goes beyond that. They have had contracts which were, as I point out in the report, were executed in an earlier age, which essentially will not allow, in many cases, capital to receive any compensation, and that produces a lot of tension. You don't have contracts like that in the investment banking business or Wall Street generally, but you have that same sort of tension. And changing a culture around, A, takes time, and B, probably takes some change in people. I mean, I don't think that's a great surprise if you expect to do it. I don't think you can find two better people than Bob Denham and Derek Maughan, and they're smart, they're high grade, they're willing to work very hard, and there will be people that buy into the arrangements they want to have, and there are people that won't. Not all of the people that have left by a long shot are leaving of their own volition, but most of them are. But some aren't. I mean, Solomon lost a lot of money last year, and many of the people that have left were not responsible for some of those losses, but some of the people were. So that is not something where you announce names in the paper, but some people are leaving because they can make more money elsewhere, and some people are maybe leaving because we think we can make more money without them. Charlie?
Yeah, I don't think the tensions that have been commented on within Solomon are all that unusual. I think they pretty well exist everywhere on Wall Street, and even in the banks, which have tried to imitate Wall Street. I just think it comes with the territory.
I don't know what percentage of the Goldman Sachs partners left this year, but they had tensions that were produced, obviously, when they had a bad year. And they're going to have a bad year from time to time. Everybody's going to have a bad year, but the partners, the general partners of Goldman Sachs, and the year ended November 30th, 1994, did not do well. They may not have done anything at all, and they'd made some very big money in prior years, and they'll probably make some very big money in subsequent years. But in the year when they didn't make any money, there was a lot of turnover. Maybe some of that turnover also was not all at the volition of the general partners that you read about leaving. I don't know the facts in that case, but There's a certain amount of tension that exists in Wall Street under any circumstances, and when you aren't making money, there's a lot of tension. Zone three.
Yeah. My name is Michael Johnson. I'm a native of Omaha, and however, my family and I are Americans living abroad in Dhahran, Saudi Arabia. My question is related to intrinsic value and Ben Graham's security analysis. I read a book earlier this year by Janet Lowe, who said that you were more toward the first or second editions of security analysis and not so much toward the fourth. Yet the fourth edition seemed to move more toward growth and value being kind of joined at the hip, like you've said in your last few annual reports. And so if I'm a person that's always studying security analysis like I do, I think I spend more time at that. Do you think I need to get those first editions, or is the fourth edition kind of more what you've moved toward with your comments such as value and growth are joined at the hip?
Janet Lowe is here, incidentally, today. She wrote a very good book on Ben Graham. I recommend that any of you that haven't read it go out and buy a copy. I think the second edition is cheaper to buy than the first edition by some margin, and I think it's basically the same book. So that's the one I would recommend. It isn't because of differences on value and growth. I just think that the reasoning is better and more consistent throughout the second edition, which is really the last one that Ben was the 100%, along with Dave Dodd helping him in various ways, was responsible for writing. And I think that the book has gotten away to quite an extent from both Graham's thinking and from his way of expressing himself. So I have no quarrel with anybody who wants to read later editions at all. I do think probably the second edition, if you're a real student of security analysis and you read and understand that, you should do all right. In terms of a lot of the mistakes that were made in terms of junk bonds and accounting and all of that sort of thing, were covered in 1934 in that first edition, and subsequently in 1940 in the second edition. There's a lot of meat in there. Later on, I must admit I didn't read the last edition as carefully as the earlier ones, but it struck me it was what was said was not as important, and it wasn't said as well, and it was more expensive.
Charlie, you have any thoughts on that?
No.
Zone four.
Yes, Jeff Peskin from New York City, and I have a question out of the annual report where you say that obviously going forward, due to the size of Berkshire, the returns going forward probably won't match the returns of the past. And then you go on to state that one thing that may hinder that is the fact that you don't really like to sell companies that you own. And I would just like to know what the reasoning is in that, if you've got a company or investment that you don't think is going to do as well as where you could put the money going forward, what really the reasoning is for holding on and not redeploying the money elsewhere.
Yeah. I'll just correct you just slightly on that. I didn't say we'd probably do worse than the past. I said we will do worse than the past. I mean, there's no way we could match percentage numbers of the past. We would, in a period that would not take that long, we would, assuming we paid out nothing, we would gobble up the whole GDP, which is something we may think about occasionally, but we don't really expect to accomplish. And the second point that relates to size. That does not relate to our unwillingness to sell businesses, because that unwillingness has existed for decades. But the size has not existed for decades. The size is, doubling 12 billion or so is harder than doubling 1 billion too, which was harder than doubling 120 million. I mean, there's no question about that. So eventually, well, already it will be a drag on performance. It doesn't mean that the performance will be terrible, but it does mean that 23% is an historical figure that has no predictive value. The unwillingness to sell businesses, like I say, goes back a long way. That is not what if that hurts performance, it's peanuts. That's simply a fact, a function of the attitude Charlie and I have, is that if we want to live our lives, we find it a rarity when we find people in the business that we want to associate with. When we do find that, we enjoy it. We don't see any reason to make an extra 0.5% a year or 1% a year. Don't try us on higher numbers, but we don't see a reason to go around ending friendships we have with people or contact or relationships. It just doesn't make any sense to us. We don't want to get committed to that sort of activity. We know we wouldn't do it if we were a private company. Now, in Berkshire, we feel we've enunciated that position. We want to get that across to everybody who might join with us, because we don't want them to expect us to do it. We want them to expect us to work hard to get a decent result and to make sure that the shareholders get the same result we get and all of that sort of thing. But we don't want to enter into any implicit contract with our fellow shareholders that will cause us to have to behave in a way that we don't want to behave. If that's the price of making more money, it's a price we don't want to pay. There's other things we forego also, but that is the one that people might disagree with us on. So we want to be very sure that everybody understands that going in. That's part of what you buy here, and I don't think it'll hurt performance that much anyway. But to the extent it does, it's a limitation you get with us. Charlie?
I don't think there's any way to measure it exactly, but my guess is that if you could appraise something you might call the character of the people that are running the operating businesses in Berkshire, many of whom helped create the businesses in the first place and are leading citizens in their community like the Helzbergs. I don't think there's any other corporation in America that's done as well as we have if you measure the human quality of the people who are in it. Now, you can say we've collected high-grade people, because we sure as hell couldn't create them. But one way or another, this is a remarkable system. And why would we tinker with it?
If you want to attract high-grade people, you probably ought to try and behave pretty well yourself. I mean, it wouldn't be any fun doing the other. I mean, I was in that position a little bit when I ran the partnership back in the 60s, and I really, people were coming into partnership with me, and my job was to turn out the best return that we could. And I found that if I got into a business, that presented certain alternatives that I didn't like. So Berkshire's a much more satisfactory in that respect. Zone 5.
John Rankin, Fort Collins, Colorado. Thanks for having us. In the book, Warren Buffett Way, the author describes the capital growth model that you've used to evaluate intrinsic value in common stock purchases. My question is, do you also still use the formula Ben Graham described in The Intelligent Investor that uses evaluating anticipated growth but also book value? It seems to me that fair value is always a bit higher when using Mr. Graham's formula than the stream of cash discounted back to present value that is in Warren Buffett Way and also that you've alluded to in annual reports.
Yeah, we've tried to put in the annual report pretty much how we approach securities. And book value is not a consideration, virtually not a consideration at all. The best businesses, by definition, are going to be businesses that earn very high returns on capital employed over time. So by nature, if we want to own good businesses, we're going to own things that have relatively little capital employed compared to our purchase price. That would not have been Ben Graham's approach. But Ben was not working with very large sums of money, and he would not have argued with this approach. He just would have said his was easier. And it is easier, perhaps, when you're working with small amounts of money. My friend Walter Schloss has hewed much more toward the kind of securities that Ben would have selected, but he's worked with smaller amounts of money. He has an absolutely sensational record, and in, it's not surprising to me at all. I mean, when Walter left Graham, though, I would have expected him to do well. But I don't look at the primary message from our standpoint of Graham really as being in that in anything to do with formulas. In other words, there's three important aspects to it. You know, one is your attitude toward the stock market. That's covered in Chapter 8 of The Intelligent Investor. I mean, if you've got that attitude toward the market, you start ahead of 99% of all people who are operating in the market, so you have an enormous advantage. Second principle is the margin of safety, which again gives you an enormous edge and actually has applicability far beyond just the investment world. And then the third is just looking at stocks as businesses, which gives you an entirely different view than most people that are in the market. And with those three sort of philosophical benchmarks, the exact evaluation technique you use is not really that important, because you're not going to go way off the track whether you use Walter's approach or Walter Schloss's or mine or whatever. Phil Carre has a slightly different approach, but it's got those three cornerstones to it, I will guarantee, and believe me, he's done very well. Charlie?
Yeah, to the extent that the method of estimating future cash flow requires projections, I would say that projections, while they're logically required by the circumstances, on average do more harm than good in America. Most of them are put together by people who have an interest in a particular outcome, and the subconscious bias that goes into the process and its apparent precision makes it it's fatuous or dishonorable or foolish or what have you. Mark Twain used to say, a mine is a hole in the ground owned by a liar. And a projection prepared in America by anybody with a commission or an executive trying to justify a particular course of action will frequently be a lie. It's not a deliberate lie in most cases. It's the man has gotten to believe it himself, and that's the worst kind. So I don't think projections are to be handled with great care, particularly when somebody has an interest in misleading you.
Charlie and I think it's fair to say we've never looked at a projection in connection with either a security we bought or a business we've bought. We've had them offered to us in great quantities. Now, the fact that we voluntarily turned them away when people tried to thrust them upon us. I mean, the very fact that they are prepared so meticulously by the people who are selling the businesses or by the executives who are presenting to their boards and all of that sort of thing, you know, I mean, either we're wrong or they're wrong. I mean, it's a ritual that managers go through to justify doing what they wanted to do in the first place. In about nine cases out of 10, I have never met an executive who wanted to buy something that said, "Well, I had to turn it down because the projections didn't work." I mean, it's never happened. And there will always be somebody that will come up with the projections that will satisfy the guy who's signing his paycheck or who will sign the deal that provides the commissions, and they will pass those along to whomever else they need, the bankers or the board, to approve it. And it is total nonsense. I was recently involved in a situation where projections were a part of the presentation, and I asked that the record of the people who made the projections, their past projections, also be presented at the same time. It was a very rude act, and
it was regarded as apostasy.
But believe me, it proved the point. I mean, it was a joke. I mean, so we'll leave it at that. We're going to have one more question, maybe, and then we'll take a break. And Charlie and I will be eating up here. The ones who want to stick around can stick around, and the ones who are in the other room, undoubtedly there will be seats in here to fill, so we'll sort of regroup in 10 or 15 minutes, and then we'll go on as long as that group lasts. So let's take one more from zone six, and then we'll take a break.
Hello, my name is Peter Bevelin from Sweden. What is the absolutely first question you ask yourself when you look at a potential investment? And do you and Mr. Munger ask yourself the same first question?
Yeah. Well, I think I don't ask myself whether Charlie's going to like it, because that will be a tough one. Now, the first question is, can I understand it? Unless it's going to be in a business that I think I can understand, there's no sense looking at it. There's no sense kidding myself into thinking that I'm going to understand some software company or some biotech company or something of the sort. What the hell am I going to know about it? I mean, you know, I can. So that's the first threshold question. And then the second question is, you know, does it look like it has good economics? Has it earned high returns on capital? You know, does it strike me as something that's likely to do that? And then I sort of go from there. How about you, Charlie?
Yeah, we tend to judge by the past record. By and large, if the thing has a lousy past record and a bright future, we're going to miss the opportunity.
Yeah. We'll take a break now, and we'll reconvene in 10 or 15 minutes. Those of you who are in the other room want to come in, and we'll stick around then. If you want to get some food and come back later, you're welcome to do that too. Thanks. Okay, we're ready to start here with a question from Zone 1. If you'll take your seats, please. We've got a...
Mr. Buffett, I'm Brian Murphy from Clearwater, Florida. I'd like to ask you a question concerning your present thinking behind your acquisitions of banks such as PNC and SunTrust, particularly in light of the fact that banks were selling so cheaply in 1990 and now many have tripled in price. And it would appear from recent publications in the financial literature that you've become much more interested in banks at these higher prices relative to the 1990 valuations. Could you comment on your thinking there?
Yeah, we really have no different, there's no difference in the criteria we apply to banks than do to other businesses. And a couple of publications have maybe made a little more of that than is warranted, because I doubt if there's more than a couple percentage points difference. And we don't think of it that way, incidentally. And we do not have a lot of sector, we don't have any sector allocation theories whatsoever. So we simply apply the same criteria when looking at banks that we would at any other business. Maybe half or maybe even a little more of the reports about our activities are in the press are erroneous. Now, some are accurate, too. And then, of course, some are way out of date. I mean, we get confidential treatment on the filings we make with the SEC as to our holdings. So they're published well over a year after we filed them. And therefore, there have been a couple of stories in the last month or two as to something we bought. And, of course, if you read the story carefully, we bought it a year and a half ago maybe, and we may have sold it, we may have bought more, all kinds of things. So that I'd be careful about press reports generally. We bought a bank for Berkshire in 1969, the Illinois National Bank and Trust of Rockford. We've had an interest in the banking business. Or we feel it's something that that falls within our circle of competence to evaluate. That doesn't mean we'll be right every time, but we don't think it's beyond us to understand the banking business. So we look at businesses in that area. Charlie?
Nothing to add.
Okay. And do we have... Zone 2.
Larry Myers from Omaha. Warren, two quick questions. The first one very brief. Do you have any timetable regarding when you will write your own book about your career in philosophy?
Yes, my timetable has always been 6 months from now. The answer on that is I've thought about doing it a few times, and I think about it. It always seems to me there's way more interesting, there are more interesting things yet to happen than have happened so far, and I don't want to, I know I won't write a second one, so I keep postponing it. That's my rationale on it anyway.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Second question concerns dividends. Last Friday night, by coincidence, on Louis Rukeyser's weekly television show, the special guest was Philip Curray. And Mr. Curray made the statement that his favorite American stock is Berkshire Hathaway. And one of the major reasons he stated was that Berkshire has never paid a dividend, as we all know, and consequently you had superior utilization of the extra cash. Now, if you extend that reasoning, could it also be a beneficial policy if Coca-Cola and Gillette stop paying dividends and utilize the cash in other ways?
Well, it depends what they could use, how they would utilize the cash and what they could use it for. Those are more focused enterprises than Berkshire, at least in terms of products. And they, I think, I commend managements that have a wonderful business for utilizing cash in those wonderful businesses or in businesses that they understand and will also have wonderful economics, and for getting the rest of the money back to the shareholders. So Coca-Cola, in my book, is doing exactly the right thing with its cash when it uses all the cash that it can effectively in the business to expand in new markets and all of that sort of thing. But then beyond that, it pays a dividend, which distributes cash to shareholders, and then it repurchases shares in a big way, which returns cash on a basis to shareholders, but in a way that benefits all of them. So you will benefit from us not paying dividends just as long as we can use every dollar we retain to produce more than a dollar of value and of market value over time. Whether we can continue doing that, how long we can continue doing that, I can't promise you, but that's the yardstick by which the decision is made. And that is the yardstick, I think, by which Coca-Cola is making the decision, too, and I think that they deserve great credit for exercising the discipline to quit when they using cash when they run out of the opportunities to use it well, and then to use it, then to further deploy it advantageously by repurchasing shares. I think one of the things I admire about my friend Bill Gates, he's got $4.5 billion of cash and Microsoft, and very few managements can stand having $4.5 billion of cash and not doing something unintelligent with it. So far, it's made sense for us to retain everything we earn, and I think it'll make sense for a while longer, but it may not make sense indefinitely. Charlie?
I hope it lasts a long time.
Zone 3.
My name is Dan O'Neill from Santa Fe, New Mexico, and I would like to ask you a more specific question about Salomon Brothers, which is, why do we pay our employees there so much?
Why what?
Why do we pay our employees there so much money? The conventional theory seems to be that there's just a different pay scale on Wall Street than the rest of the world, and it's based on the idea that traders are smarter than that some traders are smarter than others, and in some supernatural way are able to receive signals that the future is sending back to the present. And how do we know that that isn't just an urban legend, like alligators in the New York City sewers? Another theory would be that the large amount of shareholders' capital allows the traders to capture inefficiencies that are in the market in the same way that the house does in Las Vegas. I mean, if we owned a casino, it wouldn't make any difference if we hired Albert Einstein or Forrest Gump to run the blackjack table, and we would pay them the same. And I wonder which theory you think is closer to the truth.
Well, you put it well. In the end, of course, you end up paying them at what you think, at least, is a market rate, and to some extent the market tests you out by whether people leave because they can get a higher rate, but the limiting factor on that should be that you pay them a market rate as long as you are getting a market rate on capital. But it is harder to measure the market rate on capital in a short period than it is to measure the market rate on compensation. So a good many of the people that have left, but far from all, have left because they felt that they would obtain, presumably because they would obtain greater compensation elsewhere. The market was working in that way, just as it works in entertainment that way, and it works in the athletic field that way. And whether it, when it works that way, it leaves a return for capital that's adequate is an open question. I mean, I haven't looked at the figures on all the baseball teams, but I've seen some of them. And certainly in some of the smaller markets, it really, I mean, the books were not phony. I mean, it is very hard to pay market rates for ball players in Kansas City and still make money running a ball team. Well, you've got a smaller television market and all of that of the big cities. So in the end, you're going to have to pay market rates to retain people, but part of that will also depend upon the period over which they measure their what they're going to be paid. I mean, if you want to look at Goldman Sachs last year, they were paid nothing. Does that mean that everybody will leave because they can get paid something someplace else? No, because 80% of the partners or 90% of the partners have a longer time horizon than that, and they have an anticipated earnings figure in mind when comparing it with what they're being offered elsewhere. If you have a situation where market rates, you know, exceed the earning capacity of the business, then at some point capital will flow away from the business. In the airline industry, which I use as an example, the market rate, in terms of the bigger airlines, people are not being paid market rates, they're being paid contractual rates. Well, you can't blame anybody for that. If you have a contract that entitles you to X and the current market is a half of X, you're going to hang on to that contract very aggressively. And like I say, you don't blame anybody for that. It's just if you end up in that condition, though, you've got a real problem. And if you have the same problem that you have if the market is higher than, or similar problem, the one you have if the market is higher than one that you can sustain in your own business. My guess is in effect, Solomon has put in a more Goldman Sachs-like system because essentially it created, to a degree, a partnership within it. To have that work, A, over time the partners have to earn good money, and it won't work, but B, you have to have people that have a partnership mentality in it. And if you change from one culture to another, you are not going to get 100% acceptance of any new system. Charlie?
Yeah, it was kind of a bad break to put in a new compensation system and then have a very bad year. In the very nature of things, people are going to blame the compensation system subconsciously. And then, too, I think that Wall Street generally has more envy, jealousy effects than are typically present elsewhere. I have a friend whose grandmother used to say that she couldn't understand why people got into envy jealousy because it was the only one of the sins that you could never possibly have any fun at. But generally speaking, on Wall Street, I think a lot of people have had the wrong kind of grandmothers.
Yeah, I've commented from time to time that Robin Leach has it all wrong on Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous because he's presenting all these wonderful things that will happen to you if you get rich, but they really aren't that all that wonderful, these fancy houses and boats and all that. That the real advantage of being rich, as I explain to people, is that it enables you to hate so effectively. That if you're terribly rich, you know, but your brother or, you know, whatever, whomever, cousin or somebody is getting a little more attention in the world or something of the sort, you can hate in a very major way. You can hire accountants and lawyers to cause them all kinds of trouble. If you're poor, you just snub them at Thanksgiving and don't show up or something of the sort. But I've noticed that these rich people, particularly when they inherit great amounts of money, sooner or later they start, frequently they get very antagonistic toward siblings or cousins or whatever it may be, and they really can hate in a way or get envious in a way that the rest of us really can't really aspire to. So That's a benefit that hasn't appeared on Robin Leach lately. But you see that, you see a little of that in the athletic field and the entertainment field, and perhaps even in Wall Street, that that making $1 million a year looks great until this guy that sits next to you that can't possibly be as smart as you is making $1 million too, and then the whole world it turns into a very unfair place. Zone four.
Good afternoon. My question is simply about the cash and cash equivalents that are shown on the balance sheet this year versus last year. In my thinking, cash equivalents is always something good to have around in case of a big market drop, being able to make opportunistic buys, as I know you've referred to Mr. Market getting manic depressive at times. Is there something that is less than obvious here that I'm not seeing, or is the position not there now should that happen in the marketplace?
Cash at Berkshire is a residual. I mean, we would like to have no cash at all times. We also don't want to owe a lot of money at any time. But we, if we have cash around, it's simply because we haven't found anything we like to do, and we always hope to deploy it as soon as possible. We never are thinking about whether the market's going to go down or something of the sort, or whether we might buy something even cheaper. If we like something, we'll buy it. And when you see cash on our balance sheet of any size, that's an acknowledgment by Charlie and me that we have not found anything in size anyway attractive at that point. It's never a policy of ours to hold a lot of cash. Zone five.
David Winters, Mountain Lakes, New Jersey. David Winters, Mountain Lakes, New Jersey. Years ago, you said you loved the newspaper business, and then over time, I guess it said it declined a bit and how much you loved it. And I'm kind of wondering how you feel about it now and if you can prognosticate a little bit for us at all.
Well, I used to love it in two respects. I love the economics and I love the activity, both. And the love of the activity is not diminished. The economics are still exceptionally good compared to virtually any business in the world. They aren't quite as good as they were 15 years ago. So I wrote about that a couple of years ago, whereas what was seemed almost the most bulletproof of franchises is still an exceptionally good business, but it isn't quite as bulletproof as might have been the case 10 or 20 years ago. I still think it's about as interesting a business as there is in the world, I mean. But if you're talking pure economics, I can't think of many other businesses that if I just owned one asset over my life that I would rather own than a newspaper in a single newspaper town. But I wouldn't have quite the feeling of absolute certainty that I would have had 10 or 15 years ago. Charlie?
Yeah, I think it's obvious. The newspaper proprietors are getting a touch of paranoia for the first time. I mean, they worry about the electronic revolution. They worry about the fact that young people, don't read. It's not as much fun going to newspaper conventions as it used to be.
They're still making exceptional money. I mean, that's the interesting thing.
But I've heard you say a dozen times, people don't seem to care what floor they're at, just whether the elevator is going up or down.
That is true. People feel better when they're on the second floor of an elevator that's just come from one than they do when they're on the 99th floor coming down from 100. There's no question about that. They have this projection. And, of course, it's particularly the case where they've been in a business where the profits were automatic, because they start thinking about questions of whether they really have the ability to make a lot of money absent this favored position, and that's not something they've had to dwell on before, so it could make them uncomfortable. They're all screaming about newsprint prices. We probably scream about them a little bit too, but I mean, if you compare being in the newsprint business over time to being in the newspaper business, I mean, it's a joke, and newsprint prices, if you can graph them from any point, 15 or 20 years ago or 10 years ago, and the price of the newspaper, the price of advertising has gone up more. I mean, it is interesting to hear them yelling foul, because they have moved a lot in the last 12 months, and they'll move some more in the next 6 months. But believe me, it's better to be in the newspaper business than the newsprint business. Zone 6.
Mr. Buffett, my name is Liz Pruce. I'm from New York City. I was wondering on your acquisition criteria. I know part of that is that Berkshire Hathaway won't participate in unfriendly takeovers. I wondered how that philosophy may or may not apply to your role as a member of the board of several other companies.
That's an interesting question. I haven't been on the board of any company where the CEO has brought to the board the question of a hostile takeover.
Do you think anything I'm forgetting?
No, but there's no rule that can't happen. So I don't know exactly. I don't know exactly what I would do if that came along. It's a very good question. I used to have a whole different attitude on that. I mean, in effect, we actually, if you go back 40 years, we bought, in effect, control of companies. In the case of Berkshire, Malcolm Chase, the chairman, was all in favor of us buying our stock in Berkshire, but Seabury Stanton, the president, would not have been in favor of it, and Seabury was managing the business. So it wasn't hostile, but Seabury would not have been in favor of it. But Malcolm would have been. So I don't know what the situation would be today if somebody walked in at Gillette or Cap Cities or someplace like that. I don't think it's going to happen, but I have not. I don't have any policy on it at this point. What do you think we'd do, Charlie?
I don't think our behavior is totally predictable.
And he's right. Zone 1.
Yes. Neil McMahon, New York City, also a Sequoia shareholder. Ben Graham Investing encouraged turnover. Looking at Berkshire's holdings, concentration, and long term, are you still a 15% Phil Fisher and 85% Graham?
I don't know what the percentage would be. I'm 100% Ben Graham in those 3 points I mentioned earlier, and those really count. I was very influenced by Phil Fisher when I first read his two books back around 1960 or thereabouts, and I think that they're terrific books. I think Phil is a terrific guy. So I think I probably gave that percentage to, I think I first used it in Forbes one time when Jim Michaels wrote me, and I think it was one of those things I just named a number. But I think I'd rather think of myself as being a sort of 100% Ben Graham and 100% Phil Fisher in the points where they don't, and they really don't contradict each other. It's just that they had a vastly different emphasis. Ben would not have disagreed with the proposition that if you can find a business with a high rate of return on capital that can keep using more capital on that, that's the best business in the world. And of course, he made most of his money out of Geico, which was precisely that sort of business. So he recognized it. It's just that he felt that the other system of buying things that were statistically very cheap and buying a large number of them was an easier policy to apply, and one that was a little more teachable. He would have felt that Phil Fisher's approach was less teachable than his, but his had a more limited value because it was not workable with really large sums of money. At Graham Newman Corp was a closed-end fund. It was technically an open-end fund, but it had $6 million of net worth, and Newman and Graham, the partnership that was affiliated with it, had $6 million. So you had a total pool of $12 million. Well, you could go around buying little machine tool stocks in machine tool companies, whatever it might be, that all statistically cheap, and that was a very good group operation. If you own a lousy business, you have to sell it at some point. I mean, if you own a group of lousy businesses, you better hope some of them get taken over or something happens. You need turnover. If you own a wonderful business, you don't want turnover, basically. Charlie?
What was interesting to me about the Phil Fisher businesses is that a very great many of them didn't last. has wonderful businesses. One of his businesses was Title Insurance and Trust Company, which dominated the state of California. It had the biggest title plant, which was maintained by hand, and it had great fiscal solvency and integrity and so forth. It just dominated a lucrative field. And along came the computer. And now you could create it for a few million dollars, a title plant, and keep it up without an army of clerks. And pretty soon we had 20 different title companies, and they would go to great big customers like big lenders and big real estate brokers and pay them outlandish commissions by the standards of yore and bid away huge blocks of business. And in due course, in the state of California, the aggregate earnings of all the title insurance companies combined went below zero, starting with a virtual monopoly.
So it looked like a monopoly, didn't it?
Very few companies are so safe that you can just look ahead 20 years. And technology is sometimes your friend and it's sometimes your bitter enemy. If a title insurance and trust company had been smart, they would have looked on that computer, which they saw as a cost reducer, as one of the worst curses that ever came to man.
You can, it probably takes more business experience and insights to some degree to apply Phil Fisher's approach than it does Graham's approach. If you, the only problem is you may be shut out of doing anything for a long time with Ben's approach, and you may have a lot of difficulty in doing it with big money. But if you strictly applied, for example, his working capital test to security, you know, it will work. It just may not work on a very big scale, and there may be periods when you're not doing much. Ben really was more of a teacher than a, I mean, he had no urge to make a lot of money. It did not interest him. So he really wanted something that he thought was teachable and as a cornerstone of his philosophy and, or approach. And he felt you could read his books sitting out here in Omaha and apply buying things that were statistically cheap. And you didn't have to have any special insights about business or consumer behavior or anything of the sort. And I don't think there's any question about that being true, but I also don't think you can manage lots of money in accord with it. Zone two.
Hi, Rob Pitts, shareholder from New York City. This is a question for Mr. Munger. I've noticed in the insider sales activity sheets that you've been a rather consistent seller of your Berkshire stock over the last few months. Wondered if you would comment on why you're doing this, especially in light of the prospective tax change in capital gains where it might be reduced, which would obviously be beneficial to you and beneficial to Berkshire by reducing its deferred tax liability.
I've given away a fair amount of Berkshire in the last couple of years, and I've also sold some. I gave away the Berkshire because I thought it was the right way to behave, and I sold some because I had uses for the money.
He doesn't know anything I don't know. I when he started selling, I checked that, but... Zone three. Charlie has a very high percentage of his net worth in Berkshire, as do I. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead. I don't think it's working quite.
Hello?
Okay.
Hi. Goran Pulich from New York City. I have a two-part question. First part, very short. I think a lot of people have difficulty valuing businesses because of some convoluted accounting schemes that are out there. Do you have any suggestions in terms of books or something you can read where you can sort of make sense of some of the accounting stories that are going around?
Well, that's a good question. And Abe Breloff used to write for Barron's quite frequently on various accounting machinations, and Barron's has continued that somewhat. But you're right that there are people out there who will try to paint pictures with accounting that are something far from economic reality. And sometimes the rules of accounting themselves lead to that. I would say that when the accounting confuses you, I would just tend to forget about it as a company. I mean, it may well be intentional, and in any event, you don't want to go near it. We have never had any great investment results from companies whose accounting we regarded as suspect. I can't think of a one. Can you try?
No.
It's a very bad sign.
I made a short sale once that worked out well in a case like that.
Oh. It really, accounting can offer you a lot of insight into the character of management. And I would say there's a lot, you run into a fair amount of bad accounting. You used to call it creative accounting, but and you probably run into a lot more if it was allowed. But some companies have been able to push their auditors pretty far, and I would be very skeptical of anything that looks suspicious to you. I think there have been a couple of things written, but I can't think of where they've appeared, where people talk about the questions of what. Obviously, if some prepaid expense, deferred asset accounts start building up suspiciously high, and inventories look out of line, with sales and particularly the trend of them and all that. You want to look twice at companies like that. Life insurance, frequently that, we see weak accounting in. You can, when you don't have a product where revenues and expenses are being matched up on something close to cash in the short term, you have the opportunity for people playing games with numbers. And some people have learned how to do that very well, and they've sometimes created long-lasting stock manipulation or promotion schemes that have enriched themselves where they've enriched the managers or the creators of it at the expense of the public over time. If you ever get suspicious about accounting, just go on to the next company. Zone 4.
Yes, Ms. Wasserman from Chicago. In order to understand the reinsurance business a little better, can you explain your relationship with Lloyd's of London in the marketplace, which is probably the leader in the field, how often you compete directly or if you've ever done reinsurance business for them since they've had losses in recent years, and how you see the industry changing as their economics changes?
Well, Lloyd's, which is not an insurance company, as you know, but originally it was a place, it was a coffee house, but it's a place where a large number of syndicates operate and congregate in a given physical location, and it's had a history for larger, more exotic risks over time. Lloyd's has lost its relative position to a fairly significant degree in the last 10 or so years, in significant part because of bad results, which had the other effects of causing capital to withdraw and people who backed the syndicates to become unhappy. So Lloyd's is still an important competitive factor in the reinsurance business and in certain specialized kinds of primary insurance. It's a very, it's a very important factor, but it's not the factor it was 10 or 15 years ago, and I'm not sure how Berkshire's capital compares with the capital of all those syndicates at Lloyd's, but it certainly changed in its relative importance in the last 5 or 10 years, and the ability of Lloyd's to attract capital with the problems they had has been diminished, although they're working on that problem. But we regard Lloyd's as a competitor just like we would regard any one of a number of reinsurance companies as competitor, but we also do business with a number of syndicates at Lloyd's, and we'll probably do a lot of business over the next 10 years with various syndicates. Charlie?
Yeah, Lloyd's is a very interesting institution because it had this reputation for integrity, what they paid off and what the San Francisco fire and so on and so on. But I would argue that 10 or 15 years ago, a lot of slop and folly got into Lloyd's, and certain syndicates particularly, and too many commissions coming off the top as the same risks circulated around the system, too much fine tailoring and 3-hour lunches with fine wines. It wasn't right, and they got in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, actually, in the history of Berkshire, the most significant insurance problem we ever had was in connection with Lloyd's almost, or certain syndicates at Lloyd's, almost 20 years ago. And as Charlie said, they had this terrific reputation, behavioral reputation, over centuries. And I think that they coasted for a while on that, and we had a behavioral problem with in one situation, and it was very expensive to us. So we may have gotten an early lesson in what was coming. There are a lot of different syndicates at Lloyd's, and there are different people running them, and they have had different standards of behavior to some extent, and people who assumed that because they were dealing with Lloyd's that they would have no problems of any kind have found out otherwise. But they will continue to be a major force in insurance, and they will get by their present troubles, and they'll probably come out of it better structured than they went in. Was that zone five that we did there?
Yeah. For Christopher Jones from Scottsdale, Arizona. I had a couple of questions for you. You've mentioned several times today about the difficulty and the frustration that you both have in trying to find capable companies to acquire parts of in the United States. And I realize that, of course, when we own Coca-Cola and Gillette, we are a part of the global environment. But it's surprising to me that there haven't been any global franchises or global managements that have been interesting to either of you, that I realize in the past we've owned some pieces of some. So I was questioned, because of the size of Berkshire now, might we see something more of a global flavor to the portfolio? Yeah. And second question, you've also addressed the intelligent use of cash as something that you look for in management. Many management teams now are buying back their own shares because they can't find anything cheaper or better in the marketplace. Does your current philosophy of not buying back your own shares suggest that maybe you think Berkshire is overpriced at these prices?
Well, we've never bought back shares. We actually bought a few back in the 60s, but we basically have never bought back shares, although there were plenty of times when we thought it would be quite attractive to do it. But we've also felt that if we could create more than a dollar of market value by, and maybe well more than, well over a dollar of market value by retaining a dollar, that on balance that would work out better over time. As long as we can find ways to use the cash, which overall we feel will turn dollar bills into something larger than dollar bills, we'll keep retaining the money. And we won't measure that on whether we can find anything this week or this month, but we'll certainly measure it based on whether we can find anything in a couple of years. Always, we've had dry spells. Actually, right now there's a little more going on than usual, but we've had dry spells a lot of times over a 20 odd year period. And you know, as I said, I wound up the partnership during one dry spell, so that. It will be. It's measured partly on what's going on now, and it's measured partly on the expectancy. And I don't think whether our stock was selling at X or 3/4 of X right now would make a lot of difference. But it would make a difference if we thought we couldn't find things to do with the money externally. The question about non-domestic operations, and as you mentioned, we've got. Almost $8 billion in Coca-Cola and Gillette combined, and Coke has 80% plus of their earnings from non-U.S. sources, and Gillette has maybe 2/3 or thereabouts. So you can argue that almost 40% of the net worth of Berkshire, 35 to 40%, is operating outside the United States, right, just in those two investments alone. In terms of buying a business outright, we don't preclude buying a non-U.S. domicile business, but It's not too likely that it'll happen. We'd like to do it, particularly if it were large and if we understood it. But are we as likely to get a fix on a Helzberg's of Europe as we would a Helzberg's in the United States? You know, I doubt it. I just don't know whether we would develop as much confidence in understanding the scene in which they operated and understanding the management and all that. But we might. It would have to be a pretty simple business. And it would have to be a business where we thought we really understood the moat for a long time. And it would have to be a business where we could establish a rapport with the management, despite coming from somewhat different backgrounds. It's not impossible, but I would say it's less than likely. Charlie?
I've got nothing to add.
Zone 6?